Today we will talk about dark matter. We will talk about dark matter because I constantly see popular science articles overstating how much we really know about it. The truth is, we're still not sure that it actually exists. Before I say anything else, I have to tell you what we mean when we say dark matter. Dark matter is characterized by three properties. First, you may think it's dark, but actually it's transparent. It does not emit light, but it also does not absorb light, not at any frequency. Second, it's matter. If you have dark matter in a bag and you double the volume of the bag, then the energy density goes down to 1/2. Now, of course, we don't have dark matter in bags, but the same holds for the expansion of the universe. The energy density of dark matter falls inversely to the volume. This is not in general the case. For example, for radiation, the energy density falls faster than the inverse volume because the frequencies also redshift. Third, dark matter interacts weakly, both with itself and with other types of matter. Now, when physicists say weakly interacting, they sometimes mean as weak as the weak nuclear force, but that's not what is meant here. Dark matter interacts at least as weakly as the weak nuclear force, but it may be even weaker than that. And that's what we mean when we talk about dark matter. So why do physicists think that dark matter exists? That's because it's a good explanation for a lot of observations that have been made starting in the 1930s. First, there are the galaxy clusters. Galaxy clusters are a collection of some hundreds of galaxies that are held together by their own gravitational pull. The higher the total mass in the cluster, the higher the average velocities of the galaxies in the cluster. Now it turns out that the observed mass is not high enough to explain the observed velocities. The easiest way to fix this is to postulate that there is dark matter in the clusters. Second, galaxies. The story for the galaxies is similar to the story for the galaxy clusters. If you plot the velocity of the stars as a function of the distance from the galactic center, then, going by the normal mass only, you would expect the velocities to drop. But this is not what we observe. Instead, the velocities become constant for stars far away from the galactic center. This is what is known as a flat rotation curve. And again, dark matter is a simple way to explain the observations. Third, there is gravitational lensing. According to Einstein's theory of general relativity, the force that we call gravity is caused by the curvature of spacetime. So mass curves space and light is deviated by that curvature. This means that masses can act like lenses and they can focus light. How strongly they focus the light depends on the amount of mass. And gravitational lenses too tell us that normal mass alone is not sufficient to explain the observations. Then there is the cosmic microwave background. That's radiation at an average temperature of about 3 Kelvin that comes from all directions. It has its origin in the hot plasma in the early universe. Around the average temperature of 3 Kelvin, there are small temperature fluctuations that correspond to the places that were once a little bit hotter or a little bit colder. You can count the number of spots of a certain size, and if you plot the number of spots against the size, you get what is known as the power spectrum of the cosmic microwave background. The spectrum has a few peaks, which correspond to spots that are a little more frequent as others. The important thing is that the relative height of the peaks depends on the amount of dark matter. And again, the observations strongly speak for the presence of dark matter. Fifth, there's structure formation. As the universe expands, matter cools and it clumps and it begins to form structures. But normal matter, when it clumps, builds up radiation pressure and that acts against the clumping. Dark matter, on the other hand, interacts only weakly and so it will not build up this pressure. This means that dark matter clumps more efficiently and indeed it will then help the normal matter to clump. Without dark matter, the universe today just would not have sufficiently many structures. These five different types of evidence for dark matter have the same origin. As I said, general relativity tells us that matter curves space, and that curvature in return tells the matter how to move. This relation is captured by Einstein's field equations. In these equations, on the one side, you have the geometric quantities that describe the curvature of space and time. On the other side, you have all types of energy and mass. And please notice that it's Einstein's equations. It's a plural. It's not merely one equation, but it's actually 10 different equations. And if you solve those equations, then you know how the matter moves due to the curvature of space and time that it itself causes. What astrophysicists now do with their observations is that they go and measure what matter there is and how it moves, and then they check if it fulfills the equations. And what all these observations tell us is that no, it does not work. It does not fulfill the equations. And dark matter is a simple fix to make the two sides of the equations match again. Now this may look like a pretty dumb thing to do, because there's always some term that you can add to make the two sides of the equations match again. But the point is that dark matter is a particularly simple way to make it work. Recall that I told you that Einstein's equations are actually 10 different equations. So correspondingly, you need in general 10 different components to make the two sides of the equations match. But for dark matter, you need only one. And that one component you can define by one constant, for example, the energy density of dark matter today. So dark matter is the parametrically simple explanation. It would be even simpler if it was a kind of particle that we know already, but unfortunately that does not work. From the known particles, none really fit the bill. They either interact with light, so they are not dark, or they do not clump enough in the early universe. We also know that dark matter cannot be some kind of dark stellar object, like for example black holes or brown dwarfs, because these would give rise to frequent gravitational lensing, and we have not seen this. So we need something new, and most physicists think that dark matter is some new kind of particle. So yes, dark matter is a simple explanation, or at least it used to be, because in the last decades it has become clear that there are some observations that dark matter cannot so simply explain. Dark matter, for example, predicts density peaks in the cores of galaxies, and this is something which fits very badly with the observations. Dark matter also predicts a lot of small galaxies, the so-called dwarf galaxies, and those have not been found. The biggest problem for dark matter, however, is something that it does not predict. If you look at the stars and galaxies, you can use the observed velocity to calculate the acceleration that must be acting on the star to keep it in a stable orbit. You can also go and calculate the acceleration that comes from the pull of the normal matter only. So you have two types of acceleration. The one is the total acceleration, the other is the acceleration from normal matter only. Now you can go and plot the data for the two types of observations against each other, and you will find that they are strongly correlated. You see this very nicely in this wonderful plot from McGaugh and his collaborators. Now what this means is that if you tell me how much normal mass there is in a galaxy, I can tell you how much dark matter is in the galaxy. If you think that dark matter is an independent component in the universe, this does not make any sense. You would expect much larger variety in the data, but there's not. So that's a big mystery. There's a pattern in the data, and dark matter does not explain it. At least it doesn't explain it in any simple way. In the past 20 years, astrophysicists have tried to come up with computer simulations that would reproduce galaxies that look like the ones that we actually see. These simulations are based on the dark matter hypothesis, and for a long time they worked pretty badly. The galaxies that they got did not look like what we actually saw. But in the past two decades, they have improved their computer simulations a lot, and they have added new parameters. And now they can actually produce galaxies that look pretty much like what we see. Now this is not a prediction, because these simulations were made to reproduce what we had already observed. But this removes the tension between the data and the hypothesis of dark matter. So everything is fine, or is it? Now this is where it gets interesting, because there is an alternative explanation for the pattern in the data, and this is known as modified gravity. What is modified gravity? You can have some fun asking physicists what is modified gravity. The most common answer I get, believe that or not, is that it's dark matter if you add a term to this side of the equation, and it's modified gravity if you add a term to that side of the equation. Now that, of course, does not make any sense because you can always move the term from this side of the equation to that side of the equation. Now the somewhat more sophisticated answer is that it's modified gravity if you change the function on this side of the equation. But that's just not how modified gravity works. Yes, there are some theories of modified gravity which work this way, but these are not the theories that we usually use to explain the observations that are commonly attributed to dark matter. Instead, modified gravity changes the force of gravity, and it normally does so by introducing additional forces, or to be more specific, by introducing new fields. You have to do something of that sort because it's really hard to change anything about Einstein's theory of general relativity. Now, quantum mechanics tells us that forces are mediated by particles. So whenever you introduce a new force, you also introduce new particles, which brings up the question, well, then what is the difference between particle dark matter and modified gravity? The difference between modified gravity and dark matter is that for dark matter, the observations are explained only by the gravitational pull of the new type of matter. For modified gravity, on the other hand, the gravitational pull is not the same that Einstein taught us, or there is an additional force acting on the particles. It's this additional force that helps to explain the observed patterns in the data. This has been known since the 1980s when Milgram proposed his theory of modified Newtonian dynamics, which is also known as MOND. MOND relates to modified gravity the same way that Newtonian gravity relates to general relativity. This means MOND is an approximation that works in some cases but not in others. Modified gravity is the complete theory that reproduces MOND in certain situations. There are presently a few known such theories of modified gravity. Modified gravity works well for the galaxies, but it does not work so well for the galaxy clusters and for the cosmic microwave background. I know there are some people who want you to believe that modified gravity has been ruled out by the Bullet Cluster, but that's just wrong. The Bullet Cluster is actually a collision of two galaxy clusters, and it's an interesting case because for this cluster we have different kinds of data. We have on the one hand the emission of light at variance frequency ranges, which is shown in red, and this tells you where the normal mass is located. On the other hand, we have data from gravitational lensing, which is shown in blue, and this tells you where the gravitational pull goes. As you can see, the two blobs are not in the same places. The story now goes that this demonstrates that modified gravity must be wrong, because with modified gravity you would not be able to get the gravitational pull to go to a different place than the center of the normal mass. But that story is just not correct. As I said, in modified gravity you introduce additional forces and you also introduce additional particles. And there is no reason that the gravitational pull, especially for a dynamical system like the Bullet Cluster, should go to the same place as the normal matter. On a more general level, the Bullet Cluster is a statistical outlier. There are only two or three known clusters which collide at such high relative velocities. Time-dependent systems like this are generally hard to model, both with modified gravity and with dark matter. Using the Bullet Cluster to rule out an explanation for a pattern in the data just does not make any sense. So the situation is that dark matter works better in some cases and modified gravity works better in other cases. The big question is now, well, what is overall the best explanation? And we currently don't have a good answer to this. The reason is that no one makes direct quantitative comparisons between the two types of theories. Indeed, the answer may be a combination of the two, dark matter and modified gravity. And this is what we will talk about the next time.